Welcome to our first talk for today. How decorative concrete treatments can add value to your property's bottom line. Today, we have a very special guest to moderate this discussion. He is an internationally known architect and interior designer whose projects are frequently featured in various magazines and television programs. He pioneered the Echo House, which then was recognized by the United Architects of the Philippines, and has then elevated him as a fellow in 2013. Our moderator is also a past president of the Philippine Institute of Interior Designers and the Asia Pacific Space Designers Association. Please welcome architect and interior designer, James Calias Hau.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this unique discussion about decorative concrete. So for today's presentation, we will have two distinct speakers from an international and local perspective. Our first speaker is a construction industry professional with more than 40 years of experience. For the last 25 years, he has used his practical experiences to help explain the advancement in construction to thousands of contractors, engineers, and design professionals by surveying and providing content for several Hanleywood publications, including Concrete Construction, Concrete Surfaces, Masonry Construction, and The Concrete Producer. His articles are commonly published in industry publications and websites. Our speaker brings a practical blend of experience and research to his clients. He is an active member of several ASTM, American Society for Testing and Materials, International Technical Committees for Cement, Concrete, and Masonry. He has served on the Executive Committee of the Concrete and Concrete Aggregates, CO9. He is the current chairman of Subcommittee CO9-22, Materials Applied to Fresh Concrete, and CO9's Strategic Planning Task Group. He is also active on several technical committees at the American Concrete Institute, has been a part of World of Concrete, an informal markets event. In this role, he currently serves as editor at large, helping coordinate educational and on-site activities with co-sponsors, education partners, attendees, and exhibitors. Let us all welcome Rick Yelton.
Well, thank you, Ruben, for the introduction. For the next 20 minutes or so, I'll be sharing some insights with you and examples of why hotel managers should consider decorative concrete on their properties. Concrete's always been the foundation of civilization, and now, in recent years, architects and design engineers are pushing the limits of concrete in both shape, texture, color, surfaces. And today you'll learn another important attribute about decorative concrete: safety. So let's begin our discussions with an overview of my presentation. Philippine hotel operators have relied on concrete to provide the foundation for their structures and provide safety for their clients. But have you considered how decorative concrete can enhance your property's image and your operating bottom line? My presentation will focus on three areas of why I think you should consider decorative concrete techniques. First, I'll give you a little quiz to help provide an overview of the early history of modern decorative concrete. Second, I'll offer three reasons why you should consider decorative concrete on your properties. And finally, I'll share some new applications and products that contractors around the world are using to meet their owner's demand for artistic yet durable projects. We tend to think of decorative concrete as a relatively new invention, but it's a little older than you think. So for my first trivia question, let's ask, when were the first decorative techniques of staining and stamping first commercialized in North America? Well, you might be surprised that decorative concrete has been commercially available for more than 100 years. Concrete historians give credit to Lynn Mason Schofield, an engineer and inventor from Chicago, that introduced the first products in 1915. His proprietary systems make concrete not only more beautiful, but more durable. And the company still exists. But today, there are many companies around the world that have expanded on those ideas and have made them better. So for the second question, question number two, where was the first polished concrete floor installed in a hotel? Today, polished concrete floors have been installed in millions of projects around the world. The interest beyond decorative images of provide greater, the decorative concrete polishing gives, provides better light reflectivity, less maintenance, and more sustainable qualities, and made polished concrete the choice of most designers. But this was not always the case. While hard trowel floors have been around for a long time, polished surfaces are relatively new. So where was the first one? It was at the Bellagio Hotel in Las Vegas. Interestingly enough, it was not used on an interior floor. It was used on a garage entryway to provide better lighting from the underground garage to go into the main hotel. So the third decorative question is of the early history of decorative concrete is, what famous American is identified with exterior use of decorative concrete in a hospitality, the first use in a hospitality setting? Prior to the 1960s, decorative concrete surfaces were really limited to residential and special structures. So let's see who that person was. Well, actually, the answer is Mickey Mouse. Well, maybe the Walt Disney Company. There's a unique story about the first use of decorative concrete in a commercial setting or hospitality setting. It was back in 1955. The Disneyland was being built in California. The engineers opted to use asphalt as the main pavements for the iconic park. But a few months after the park was open, it became very warm. Back in the 1950s, women wore high heel shoes to visit the iconic Disneyland park. And as the summer got warmer, the asphalt got softer. And after a while, there were a number of women who had their ankles damaged by having the heel stick into the asphalt. And after that, decorative concrete has been a mainstay in Disneyland everywhere. But if you really ask some of the Disneyland Imagineers, they look at decorative concrete as a way to create a sense of spirit and a sense of image for each of their parks. Now that we've looked at why there's been a legacy of decorative concrete in the hospitality industry from its start, why should hotel owners consider using this product in their properties? I think there are three main reasons. First, it allows a hotel owner and operator to make a bold statement about their property. The second one is that decorative concrete surfaces provide better floor safety against slips. And just as important, a third main reason is that decorative concrete surfaces can help create a more sustainable structure. So let's take an example of some projects around the world that are pushing decorative concrete to extremes. Well, I'll go back and start with, these are some images from Disney's Shanghai, China's new theme park. Take a look at the combination of concrete, of the colors, the hues, and the styles that create a distinctive image for that particular hospitality setting. How about this picture? This is another example of decorative concrete, not what you would normally think about. This is a roof on a train station in France. The roof is made with precast concrete, white sections, and they are self-supporting in a way to create a dynamic roof over the train floor itself. These, when you look at the picture on your right, you'll see that it looks like a special kind of piece. It was made with a special kind of product called ultra high performance concrete. And these decorative concrete pieces are as strong as steel and are able to create a beautiful white picture. How about this picture? This is an award-winning project in Santa Monica, California called the Water Garden. It's a collection of both multifamily and residential, multifamily, hotel, and businesses to create a unique feel of how water is key to the campus. Look at the center plaza where they have created a number of aqua-looking settings. And see how the building colors are matching to not only the hardscape, but also to themselves to create a unique experience. This is another unique of innovative use of decorative concrete. This is said to be the largest installation of pervious concrete in the world. Look at it. Would you think that they opted to use pervious concrete, which is a special type of concrete that allows the water to pass through it, It eliminates the need for stormwater problems. And it allows the owner to have greater use of their properties, in the U.S. because they can eliminate storm sewers, drainage ditches, and retention ponds. And one common theme that seems to be in the hospitality business right now is to provide a unique guest living experience. Just think how decorative concrete can be used to create new living cottages on large projects. And perhaps the final example of a special use of decorative concrete is this unique shade pavilion that was outside a large hotel in Colorado. They wanted to create a unique feeling as the guest walked into the structure. This particular material was first drafted in a 3D model, and they made special rebar to make it, you can see the rebar placement, and then they used shotcrete and other kinds of techniques to make the unique look for that particular property. The second reason why hotel owners should look at decorative property, especially for their floors, is safety. When I speak to building owners about concrete, the most common topic brought up is safety from slip and trips. And there's a good reason for it. Slip and trips probably are the number one cause of accidents in hotels, restaurants, and public buildings, according to the United States Bureau of Labor Standards. Injuries from a seemingly incidental fall are estimated to cost almost $7 billion in the U.S. in terms of payouts. Well, decorative concrete can help solve that. Several years ago, I partnered with the Floor Safety Institute to show how concrete floors compared to tile and stone floors for safety. The National Floor Safety Institute conducts training on how to measure floor slipperiness, also how to have employees be taught how to look for slippiness in their operations. And just as important, they have a list of floor safety products that have, that provide high traction and are often referenced in hotels and lodging around the US. They do this floor testing with a machine called the BOT-300E. It's an output travel meter that measures the slippiness of a floor both in wet and dry applications. It's a useful tool, and as part of our research, we tested a wide range of floors from tile to stone and to different types of concrete. And how did concrete work out? Decorative concrete surfaces were found that were stamped or imprinted were found to be more slip resistant than the smooth surfaces. It really depends on the type of treatment you provide, but it's easy to say that a very rough, very smoothly rough surface of decorative of concrete is safer. The indication is the flatter the floor, the more slip resistant it is. And that's because a visitor is able to put more of his shoe, the sole of his shoe on the floor. And decorative concrete provides that setting. I guess the other thing that we really want to talk about why hotel managers should look at use of decorative concrete is that they can create a more sustainable building. When you look at the reasons why, it's impressive. First of all, decorative concrete can help reduce the you can earn credits from LEED by reducing the urban heat island effect. Second, decorative concrete floors help improve air quality because they don't have the same problems that rugs and other materials have inside. You can recycle decorative concrete is an important thing because you can recycle and conserve materials. You can see how pervious concrete can help reduce stormwater runoff. And then the reduced construction and demolition waste because many types of overlays can be placed over the top of floors that would normally have to have been torn out to be replaced. And polished floors provide an opportunity for the polished floors reflect enough light off so that hotel owners can reduce the amount of light needed inside. So let's take a look at some of the more common practices or products that are available in the marketplace right now. And these are unique applications of types of decorative concrete that are found. I guess the first one we want to talk about are precast sound walls. Many hotel owners are looking at these products to place around the outside of their properties to help reduce sound. Look at the textures in the sound walls. These are precast elements. They can often have unique textures that are embedded during the casting process. They are very easy to install. They come precast made at the manufacturer, at the plant. They are lifted in place and they are easily erected and often reduce the overall construction time of a project. They can be colored using different types of dyes and stains to create different patterns that match the hotel setting and theme. How about this? This is an example of carving, what they call carving of concrete. The artist or the artisan actually first makes a special kind of cement that's placed up along on a vertical wall surface. They go back through with a special trowel to create all of the images that you see in these two pictures here. They often are used around fireplaces or in terms of high accent points. Notice that no two walls look alike, but they're able to come back through and provide a unique coloring to them by staining each of the wall sections to match the interior lighting and structure. This is a picture of a carving that's outside it as a water feature. The concrete wall, again, was placed and an artisan came back through to create all of the lines and provide the water path that came down. How about this? Concrete countertops are rapidly replacing a lot of stone installations in the U.S., especially in highly marketable items. You know, unique places where you want to have something that's very different. What you're looking at here, two different styles of embedded lights that are in the polished concrete surface. But not only pay attention, not only look at the lights, but look at the different coloring and staining that the artisan was able to provide that sometimes steel, that sometimes stone and granite just can't give you to create that unique look. Well, floors are a big use for decorative concrete. Take a look at this. This is a type of product called scoring. The concrete was placed on the floor, and using a special tool and grinder, the artisan came in and created different lines and different patterns and stained them afterwards. This is a very common way to create a highly accented area in a restaurant or in a large entryway. Look at here, you're looking at another process that creates a unique aspect at all. It's called stencils. After the concrete is placed, these plastic forms are placed over the concrete to create the little walking surfaces. It should be noted that the thickness of the stencil is carefully monitored to make sure that the relief does not cause any chance for tripping. Here is probably one of the more popular ways of doing decorative floors now. It's called microtopping. These are products that are placed over an existing floor that allows to upgrade the floor to a new look. Look on the left, you can see where they've used a microtopping in a kitchen or restaurant area. And on the right, you'll see a picture of a microtopping that was crafted to look almost like a wood floor, but have all the benefits of safety, durability, and maintenance and low maintenance as a concrete floor offers. How about this is another unique application, a new product that's coming on the marketplace. These are embedded highlights into the top of the concrete. These are used in exterior settings where during the day, the little pellets that are in the concrete gather the sunlight. And when the night comes out, so do the stars on the parkway. This is an effective way to create paths in dark settings to lead from one entry point to another on a large hotel setting in Las Vegas. If you haven't been watching, but one of the greatest trends that we've been seeing is the use of water features in hotels and hospitality settings. These are examples of water features that are using specialized concrete waterproofing techniques and include all sorts of, not only include materials that are in the concrete to prevent water leakage, but also a wide range of properly designed mats and finishing tools to make sure the water stays where they're at. While we all know that we can polish concrete floors, how about polishing concrete walls? This is a very new technique that's being done in many of the high profile projects on the West Coast. In fact, the new Google offices extensively used polished walls. Look at how bright the wall is. This allows you to avoid having to cover the wall with a fabric or any kind of covering. It saves you an insulation cost during the construction, but more importantly, it allows you to reduce your lighting cost because the polished concrete allows for better reflection of light on your surfaces. The technique is relatively simple. They take a special type of machine that's placed against the wall, and they're able to properly measure the amount of pressure to give the amount of shine that the wall is supposed to have for to create better lighting. How about this? If you want to make a statement on the outside of your building, how about using precast concrete? This is a special type of technique. You can see that these are precast concrete panels that have been impregnated with a special kind of form release, so they can actually do designs like you see on the left-hand side, or they can even take pictures and have embed pictures of almost anything on a concrete surface. The life of these concrete panels are said to be upwards of 25 years, and they provide a unique way to create a setting for iconic structures. And I'll go back to the idea of using pervious concrete. Pervious concrete, again, is a special material that allows the water to pass through it without losing its ability to withstand without losing its strength. Look at how you can create different patterns in your exterior walkways. And again, one of the benefits of pervious concrete, decorative pervious concrete especially, is it allows the owner to reduce the amount of area that he needs to set aside for drainage or stormwater retention, and often allows him to save up to 25%, have a greater use of their property by almost 25%. Well, we've given you a pretty great overview of what's happening in the decorative concrete business. I'd like to give you two great resources that you can look on to get some ideas about how you can employ decorative concrete on your structures and your properties. Concrete Decor Magazine is a web-based magazine that provides some of the newest information out there. And the Decorative Concrete Council provides a lot of technical information that will allow your architects and design professionals to feel confident to specify decorative concrete on your future projects. Well, I want to thank you for taking time out of your personal life, your business life, and your professional life to allow me to share some ideas with you. I know there will be a question here, but if you have any questions, please feel free to email me with any questions, or if you're looking for sources for ideas or anything I can do to help you understand why decorative concrete is important and how it can help you better serve your clients and your owners by making your facility safer and more profitable. Thank you very much.
I know you have lots of questions, but before that, let us look into the local perspective first. Our next speaker finished his materials science and engineering degree from Mapua University here in the Philippines. Since then, he has been involved in the construction industry, primarily in the construction chemicals field. Now, working as a technical service engineer for Pacific Paint, he is engaged in applications, engineering, materials, testing, and design. Please welcome Engineer Calvin Trilles.
Good day. My name is Calvin Trilles, and I'm a technical service engineer for Construction Chemicals. Today, I'll be discussing with you what we call the Lunar Series. Basically, the Lunar Series is a compilation of our concrete design concepts that we've developed through our many years of experience with paints and construction chemicals. but more on that later. We believe that it's imperative for us to first fully understand why are we talking about decorative concrete? Why are we talking about aesthetics in design? This is to also reinforce what Mr. Rick Yelton was mentioning in his decorative concrete seminar. A study done by S.S. Uzunoglu in 2012 entitled Aesthetics in Architectural Education elaborates exactly the integral part aesthetics play in design. She mentions, and I quote, "As aesthetics is important for the physiological and psychological well-being of humans, the importance of finding ways to make the environment livable and more pleasing through aesthetic approaches should be understood by the architects and the designers. This is exactly the reason why the Lunar series was developed." Let's roll back to what Lunar series is all about. The Lunar series is basically a design series crafted to satisfy clients' aesthetic requirements, all the while maintaining material quality and material reliability. All the design concepts that will be mentioned here incorporate their own construct systems, which ensure that the quality of the output that you get is of the premium tier. Some of you may be also interested to know why we label this series this way. But as you may have already guessed, this is actually inspired by the fascinating features of the moon. The faux finishes included here are striking, but not overwhelming. I bet we can all agree that cement finishes, while minimalistic, provide a level of sophistication to our living spaces. So first in our list is what we call cavern. As you may observe, this design resonates a raw concrete look. Rough, sturdy, solid. It's perfect for your accent walls in your living rooms and your bed areas. This design incorporates Construct's Permaplast K202 high-performance acrylic render mixed with cement and applied by seal trowel. For exterior areas such as facades or perimeter walls, coastal can be a good consideration. This is more commonly known here in the Philippines as the stucco finish. Just imagine having this kind of finish near your pool areas. It's like having a beach sand of your own, except it's beach sand on your walls. This design incorporates Construct Permaplast K231 decorender, applied using a steel trowel and flattened by a plastic trowel to finish. Next on the list is what we call casa. This finish features geometric lines, which is a great way to offset otherwise flat walls. This appeals to designers who put great emphasis on geometry and symmetry on their work, as the vertical lines meet with the floor and the ceiling. On the other end, this design incorporates Construct Permaplast K2102, a skin coat applied via steel trowel and finished off with a stiff brush. Another interesting design that we have developed is what we call coral. Unlike the geometric features of casa, coral is marked by randomly placed wrinkles and peaks and valleys. Come to think of it, it somewhat emulates what the surface of the moon looks like. That's why it's perfect for accent walls in your family rooms and your receiving areas. To achieve such a finish, we would need to use Construct Permaplast K210 2K skin coat applied using a steel trowel. Another tool that we would need to use is a spaghetti roller to achieve the depth and the wrinkles that we want in this kind of design. Abstraction seems to be a good principle that our interior designers are employing nowadays in their work. Corona is actually aligned to that kind of principle. Corona exhibits flow and irregularity, a perfect way to offset walls in your living rooms and your bed areas. Likewise, it utilizes Construct Permaplast 2K skin coat applied using a steel trowel at a certain technique. Moving forward, designs like Kaiser are among the most popularly employed faux finishes today. We can see it in homes, in hotels, in shops in any nature, and many others. You see, what's interesting about finishes like Kaiser is that it brings out a rustic vibe, a sophisticated feeling, especially when paired with wood. Actually, the stylish contrast between concrete and wood, it brings out the elegance of both materials individually and also as a combination in the design. Kaiser and Kashmir are two closely related designs. In fact, both designs utilize Construct's Permaplast K201 High Performance Acrylic Skim Coat. This acrylic skim coat is to be mixed with cement, either ordinary Portland or white cement, to achieve that gradient that we desire in our finish. The only difference though for Kaiser and Kashmir are the clear coats, with Kaiser having the matte finish and the Kashmir having the clear gloss finish. Concrete's innate attribute is its appearance of strength, its durability, and its density. This is perfectly exemplified by the design concept we call Canyon. From its namesake, Canyon features peaks and valleys, which provide definite depth and texture. This is a good choice for your partition walls and even for your facades. To achieve such a look, we would need to use Construct's Permaplast K202 High Performance Acrylic Render, applied using a mortar gun and finished off with a wooden roller. Speaking of concrete character, coal is another concrete design concept that you can use for your accent walls. The texture achieved from using the same K202 material and the mortar gun provides a luxurious touch to elevate your furniture and other interior design elements. The designs that we have outlined are just some of the elaborate concrete concepts that are present in the market today. Of course, faux finishes are not limited to vertical application. It's the same reason why we at Construct have expanded our studies and even went as far as to producing designs for flooring. We present to you Lunar Series Archistone. Fundamentally, the Lunar Series Archistone is a collection of design concepts developed to capture the elegance and simplicity of concrete on floors. Think of industrial look parkways and receiving areas inside your home. To achieve such finishes, we make use of premium quality Construct flooring materials. We likewise labeled as Archistone, either applied as overlayment or as screed. As I conclude this webinar, I want to share an important note as to the reason why I think cement finishes are in today. I think at the end, faux finishes reinforce the idea that less is more. The most luxurious designs today are classified, characterized by simplicity and clarity, and I think cement and concrete is the perfect material to do just that. It allows designers to be minimalistic while also being free and shifts the focus only to the most vital elements of the design. That concludes our seminar. My name is Calvin A. Trilles. If you have more inquiries, please feel free to contact our technical service department or reach us through our Facebook, facebook.com/constructchem, for more information. Thank you again for making the time today.
Okay, that was a very exciting presentation today. So we heard, starting with Mr. Rick Yelton, and it was exciting that he brought us back to the trivia questions and then the surface applications, particularly that concrete can make a bold statement in our projects, particularly hospitality design. And of course, it adds to the better safety for floor and with the next speaker, he showed us the application, particularly on wall surfaces, on how we can enhance the interiors using concrete treatment made of construct in different applications. So I can see there are several questions. May I read a few of them? Okay. Starting with Mr. Henry Koh. He wants to know if there's a comprehensive textbook or manual that we can buy or download for decorative and functional concrete design or manufacturing. So maybe we can address this to our speaker, Mr. Yelton.
So there are several manuals. Are we, I guess the question is, are we looking for installation or for the making of the materials? But if there are three very good manuals to talk about how to apply decorative concrete surfaces. And if he emails me, I can give him a link to a website page that has some very detailed information on it. But there are three very good manuals available right now.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Yelton. Maybe you can send us the link for that information manual, and then we can share it with the audience.
Okay.
And then the next question is, what are the most valid and valuable tools or simulation software to optimize building design, especially, of course, we cannot physically look into the product, but we can do it virtually.
So are you asking, are there
software? Are there any software available in the market?
There are some softwares available that can implant different concrete designs on the floor. So different techniques, but they're typically owned by the manufacturers. So I'm not aware of anything that's commercially available for an architect or design to use right now.
Okay, thank you very much. Another question is, since concrete is composed of cement, how can it help in the preservation of our natural resources, considering the effects of mining to global warming and depletion of our forests and natural land formation? So this is more about sustainability and maybe end of product cycle of the of concrete.
Yeah, that's a great question. That question comes up all the time because we all know that in the manufacturing cement, there is a emission of CO2. But when you look at concrete, you have to look at the third order of life. You have to look up at the ability for a concrete floor to have a long service life. You have to look at the ability for the fact that concrete is a durable material and has a long service life. And there's another interesting fact about concrete that many people don't realize. Concrete's a live chemical, right? It is a material that has a life. And in its life, concrete reabsorbs CO2 back in it as it's in the atmosphere. So while there is a concern about global warming, when you look at the use of concrete in a way that is that provides a sustainable answer and also resilient material, it is environmentally friendly when used properly.
I agree with that. I think concrete is one of the most green and sustainable material that we can use because it has the end of life cycle and it can go back to the earth. Okay, here's another question.
Let me offer one more thing.
I've
been working with the Philippine Constructors Association for a long while. You'd be amazed by how much their members are trying to make concrete better by using less cement in it. So not only are the concrete that was placed 15 years ago is much different than it is right now. So even the material itself is more sustainable.
Okay, so another question is about the uses for industrial heavy traffic flooring. I think you have shown that in some of the slides that you have presented.
I think in ACI, the American Concrete Institute, there are several types of concrete floor classifications. So the question is when I think of high traffic floors, I think of industrial or warehouse floors. But when in this setting, when I think of high traffic floors, you're looking at high pedestrian use floors. So there are two levels of flooring that is acceptable for that standard. And each of those has different mixture contents that are to be used.
Okay, thank you. So here's another question. Where can we buy, let's see this. Where can we buy precast sound walls in the Philippines? So this is about local sourcing already. So maybe our speaker from Boysen can discuss about this.
Well, for precast sound walls, we don't necessarily have that manufactured in our company. But I bet there are companies in the Philippines that can actually serve that or serve that need. No, the Philippines, the precast concrete is actually growing, as we've observed in our visits from job sites. But yeah. I think there are a certain number of companies that can serve that kind of need.
Okay, thank you, Calvin. Now, there are some questions here in the chat room. So, since concrete is composed of cement, that has been already discussed. How long does stamped concrete last? And how to deal with color variations in case color does not match? Do we have any decorative concrete contractors locally? So this is about stamped concrete. So maybe we can start first with Mr. Yelton, and then Calvin can also add into the idea and how to make especially particularly color variations. Mr. Yelton?
Great question. There's two life cycles of a stamped concrete floor. First is the life cycle of the relief itself, the stamping itself. So the stamp properly installed will have a life of upwards of 20 years. Now, the second question is, after you stamp the concrete, there's often a sealer put on top of the concrete to achieve the luster or the shine that the architect or design engineer wants. Typically, that shine or luster has a life of about 5 or 6 years, depending on how the floor is cared for. In using some of the more modern materials, the life can be extended even further. So the key to that is when you put a stamped concrete floor down, that you properly clean it and avoid too abrasive of material on top of it. So it's easy answer. The stamped floor relief should last upwards of 20 years. And typically, the need to replace the sealer shining surface on it is about 5 to 7. And I imagine Calvin might have a little better answer than I would.
Thank you very much, Rick. Now, let's hear from Calvin. Calvin. Hello. Okay, can algae mold grow in pervious concrete that can cause slippiness or, algae, build up?
So the question, can the challenge with decorative concrete floors is to make them look not too shiny. So this type of sealer that goes on typically does a good job of preventing any kind of discoloration, and when properly applied, has enough thickness to handle typical common maintenance approaches.
Okay, particularly in the Philippines, which is a tropical country, because I myself had a freak accident with concrete, because when it rains continuously for days, the algae builds up immediately. And then one time I was opening arcade and it was rush and there was like a pond of water, and I practically slipped and practically broke my wrist bone. That's one thing that we want to avoid. Like I was part of that 7 billion injury that happened every year. Right. Well, I hope I did not spend a billion for that. But you know, yeah, how do, in the, maybe it's a different setting in the US, but in the tropical countries like the Philippines, that's something that we must look into, because especially in the open surface, it's subject to rain and downpour.
Yeah, and I'll answer the question this way. In the US, it's very common for the design, the engineer of record or the designer, to specify a floor flatness for an exterior concrete surface. So in answer to your question, the often when you have a flat work that has depressions in it, we call them bird baths, because they're depressions like that. They're caused because the contractor was not instructed to have a levelness factor on the floor. So in the US, and I would say in Europe as well, it's very common that the architect of record specifies a floor flatness and floor levelness for the exterior slab. And that eliminates any kind of gathering of the water. It also helps the contractor be able to understand what the designer wants. So really in the US, the more sophisticated contractors are able to provide that floor flatness for the architect, and that prevents that kind of concern that you have with water pooling or puddling on top of a concrete surface.
Okay, so in other words, there should be a certain degree of slope to drain the water into the gutter, practically. Otherwise, yeah, you said like there will be like a bird ponding that will happen in the surface. Right. Thank you very much, Rick. Now let's hear from Calvin, especially on the surface application that we have here locally.
For our local applicators, for our local materials here in the Philippines, we have two types, no? So we have overlayments and for floor screen types of materials, for construct specifically. And those kinds of materials are specially categorized as polished concrete. So we use polishing materials in order to achieve that certain kinds of finishes that we want in our designs. So right now we're working on different variations for colors of the concrete. And again, we will be informing you with that in the near future. But right now we do have certain standard colors for polished concrete. And for anyone who's interested there, we can reach out to you and have you see what polished concrete looks like here in the Philippines.
Polished concrete in terms of interior application or outdoor?
For interior application.
Surface. Okay, how about in particular for outdoor?
It's still in the works for exterior applications, but what we do have right now is for interior applications only.
Okay, very interestingly about concrete, because the modernism is practically now the trend in architecture and design and including interior. So, but it started, Rick, if you agree with me, in the 1950s with brutalism, right? Those were the days like the Mies van der Rohe, Le Corbusier were doing architecture with concrete, raw concrete surfaces, and I love them. The texture of the concrete is like as is when you take out the wooden planks, and then now it's practically back, and then everybody's, the industrial look is back. And so that what Calvin has presented us using the application of construct in different category, but I would call it in the Philippines, we call it a KKK. It was everything is construct, Canyon, Kaiser, coal. It's very interesting. Okay, I think That's very heroic in terms of the terminology that you have applied to your product. So let's start with Calvin. So yes, the application of concrete is now, what do you call this, trending in the interior design market. And a lot of interior designers are, the application is from the, not only in the common areas, but also even in the intimate space like bedroom and correct. Also the bathroom where the wet areas happen. So especially in the bathroom with there's a moisture. So how do you maintain the surface treatment using this material?
For areas with much moisture, of course, we would recommend a sealer, a type of sealer to cover the skim coat that we're going to use so that the porosity of the material won't be penetrated by that moisture and won't affect eventually the integrity of the design. So in those areas, we also recommend using acrylic type materials or acrylic based materials, which are which proves to be a better binder compared to the ones that are only polymer modified. And yeah, I think the highlight of those systems is the sealer itself. You have to seal the surface.
So you're talking, Calvin, you're talking about the acrylic emulsion.
Acrylic skim coat, sir.
Skim coat, no. Okay. But we still need to put like an emulsion on top of it or no need?
And no need for full finishes. We won't need to have a kind of acrylic emulsion, but a clear coat. A clear coat.
Yeah.
Reinforce the strength of the material.
So does it come shiny or it looks very natural, like matte finish?
We do have both materials. We have a matte finish and we have a clear gloss finish.
Because as a designer, the challenge of having a shiny, especially if you use acrylic emulsion, it looks like a wrapped in a plastic thing. And it looks kind of artificial. So we would go for the matte and maybe the satin finish with, you know, for easier maintenance.
Yes. For interiors, usually we see interior designers and architects employing the matte finishes. And I think it's a very good way to use, very good idea to use that those kinds of finishes to complement the whole design, I think, yeah.
And in terms of the algae buildup or molds, it will never happen. Is that true?
It will not happen because of the material that we're putting on top of the skim coat itself is actually solvent based, which is not prone for algae buildup.
So you're talking about solvent. Is there a formaldehyde content or zero formaldehyde?
Zero formaldehyde.
Okay, that's very important to know because the indoor air quality must be assured to our users, particularly to our clients, that even if they apply those materials or products to the surface, they will have a good indoor air quality. Now, Rick, on the application of exterior, what would you recommend, especially on a raw concrete surface that's now like a back in the design industry? Wall surface in particular.
What kind of setting are you going to be in?
You have presented some like faux stones, but now a lot of application of like just raw concrete you applied on the walls. Well, there's two things. Again, the question in the tropical countries where that it might have a buildup of algae, because even the hairline cracks, molds, or sometimes algae grow into that. So what can you recommend to mitigate those challenges?
That's a great question. What you're asking about is that if you have an exterior concrete surface and you see surface defects that have small hairline cracks, what can you do to prevent any kind of water intrusion into the cracks, right?
Yeah.
To prevent that. So there's a wide range of penetrating chemicals that are surfacely applied. One's called Penetron, P-E-N-T-R-O-N. There's a number of them out there. They're very unique. They can be applied with a roller brush, and they actually are a live chemical that when they are applied to the concrete, they form small crystals that fill in the voids that make the concrete almost waterproof. So these are crystalline admixtures. Sometimes you can, but typically they're applied after the concrete's placed, and they are really, really aggressive in closing up all of the small pores of the concrete. Because sometimes when you look at a concrete wall, not every concrete truck looks the same, right? Sometimes you see a little bit different color from one to the other, and you're trying to make that wall have some semblance of, or some, you want it to look right, but not too right. So you, in other words, you want to retain the color. You want the sand grain to come out. You want it to look, but you don't want to be painting it. So these clear crystalline structure products like Penetron can be a brush applied to the outside, and what happens is that they form a chemical bond with the existing concrete, and they prevent water intrusion inside.
Okay, so that's a very good information. We got a live chemical, so you know, with the crystal admixtures into the surface. So Calvin, on the local applications, particularly on your side, like what particular products also can you, our market, avail here in the Philippines?
To have those kinds of finishes that I've showed you.
I'm talking about outdoor now. Oh, yeah. Okay.
For exterior applications, we have the same acrylic skin coat that I've mentioned, and the acrylic render, which are for the textured finishes. Actually, these materials, when applied plainly, are meant to be for the exterior. And as part of our applications engineering, we've developed those certain designs that like Canyon, like Cashmere, and Kaiser, which are actually made of those permaplast rendering materials.
So Canyon and Kaiser can be applied externally as well? I mean, really? Oh, I thought that's only like, because you were just showing interior photos. So it can apply both exterior and interior.
Yes, some of the designs that I've shown are actually can be applied for both interior and exterior surfaces.
Do they come in different pigments or coloring, or?
Actually, the colors that we'll get depends on the cement that we mix with the material itself. So if we want a lighter gradient, we can add a higher white cement ratio to ordinary Portland cement ratio, and then we get a certain light gray color. For darker colors, we mix it fully with ordinary Portland cement, and then we get the darkest gray color.
So you can add with Portland cement, or you can add also with white cement. It depends on the grade of the tonal value of the concrete that you want. Okay. Right. Now, next question: if you add like a color, can you add coloring into that?
We're actually trying to develop certain tints for the design itself, but
or pigments.
Yeah. As of the moment, we have not produced a standard for that yet, but we're doing our studies now.
Because the next question is the ultraviolet, the sun rays, especially in the tropical Philippines, sometimes you get the extreme heat. So maybe also we can hear from Rick Yelton, like, how do you, like, if you apply a pigmented treatment on a exterior surface, how do we keep and how long will it last, Calvin? Then we'll hear from Rick.
Well, we have not produced a standard for that. But as for our experience, the pigmented designs that we have studied are only applied for interiors. There are more studies happening now in terms of that, and we'll be very much willing to share that to our audience for the next few weeks, I think.
Oh, we'll look into the new product development. So. Rick, any suggestion on the pigmented surface exterior application?
Yeah, I guess the biggest thing that I always recommend is that there is an ASTM standard. There is an ASTM standard that specifies that for pigments that are applied to concrete. Most of the pigments that are supplied to the world or from China, about 75% of those pigments are meet the ASTM standard for for durability. And what they do, they have to pass a test where they go into a light tunnel where they're measured over a year period to make sure that they're not lost. So I always tell specifiers and engineers to number one, in their contract documents, make sure that the pigments are applied to the pigments that are within the the mixtures comply to an ASTM standard. The second thing we always talk about is making sure that you understand how the water is, the biggest things I look at is if you're on a wind-blown side of a structure versus a non-wind-blown side of a structure. In other words, the prevailing water, wind goes one way. That concrete always tends to look different than it does on the other side. So we always just say, make sure you put a good sealer on that at least provides a consistent starting point to it all. And then there's another thing that I've been doing lately. There's a cool little product called the Color Muse, M-U-S-E. It's a small digital color meter. And I don't want to get into the details about difference of color. It cost about $60 US. And it allows a designer to walk around the building and make sure that all the color is within a range of what they want. And so as a result of, it's not going to be perfect, but it does at least give you some idea that the pigment that is on the structure works around the outside. And I like to do it after you apply the sealer on the outside to make sure that the applicator was consistent in the film thickness of the sealer that was applied. So the idea is that if it's consistently all around, that the applicator was consistent. He had the proper map on his roller. All the things were right. He didn't use two different rollers. So it provides a simple tool for the design professional to accept the structure when it's done.
That's very interesting. So you call it a Color Muse, M-U?
It's a commercial, it's M-U-S-E. It's a,
like a muse, like a beautiful muse.
Yes, yes.
Okay. So Calvin, I think you must have that in terms of application in local settings. So to make sure that the color consistency around the building is consistent. Okay. And also, Rick, on talking about like certain parts, especially if you're on a seaside, especially now, like I'm doing a resort project, of course, if you are facing the ocean and the sea breeze with the salt into that, so what are your recommendations?
That's another great question. We could talk for hours about corrosion resistant structures, right? We could talk about
that will be another webinar, okay?
but I think the simplest thing is there are chemicals that can be applied, that can be incorporated into the concrete that are corrosion inhibitors. So they are incorporated into the concrete initially, and they help close up they make the concrete smaller. They make the pores in the concrete smaller to prevent the salt intrusion. So if I was work, typically what I see done on balconies facing windward side of things is that they include a corrosion inhibitor admixture. Cortide, Cortide makes one. There's a couple chemically ones that are available in the Philippines, but I always would suggest that you include a corrosion inhibitor admixture.
Okay, a corrosion inhibitor material product. Okay, Calvin, on your side in the local market, what I'm talking about sea breeze, salt, So, of course, number one, consistency of color and how to prevent the corrosion or the damage on the concrete over time. So what can you suggest in terms of your product construct?
For areas with that kind of circumstance, I think just to give you, as to paint a picture on what the market it is, what market is in the Philippines today. So I think one of the most dominant materials that are used as plastering materials here in the Philippines are ordinary powder type skin coats. So one of the weaknesses of ordinary powder type skin coats is that when exposed to certain elements like extreme heat and wetness, and to add to that the near saline areas, it will most likely fail. So the thing that we're trying to push here is the use of premium acrylic materials such as the one I've mentioned, the Permaplast K201 high performance acrylic skin coat, which can withstand better or have better weather resistance compared to the ordinary type skin coats. Also, the thing I mentioned, the high performance acrylic render, another material that can be used to help weatherproofing construction areas that are near to saline areas. I think using those materials paired with ordinary with concrete, it's a good way to reinforce or make the building last longer. And partner that with the high quality paints from Boysen, I think that would be a good combination.
So that's a good tip also, like Permaplast, okay? And it's available in the depot, they can get that?
Yes, sir.
Rick, in terms of brutalism and modernism, using the black color, the normal impression is like if you use black, it absorbs more heat. But of course, modernist architects and designers would want their concrete to have some black accent. Is that true that it absorbs more heat? And then later we can hear from Calvin about the experience with that.
Yeah, you know, the problem with black is it is extremely, extremely difficult to get a consistent hue of black in concrete. And that's because, there's two reasons for that. First of all, is the fact that the water cement ratio of every concrete is a little bit different. And then the second thing is that the best black concrete I've ever seen included a very expensive obsidian, almost a black aggregate, in order to provide the whole blackness to it all. So really, in answer to your question, can you gain more heat? Will concrete absorb more heat? If it's black, of course it will. But I think that the challenge with black has more to do with it's very, very difficult to get to find the consistent pigment that goes to it all. And most time it's just very difficult to gain a consistent color.
Okay, Rick. So in other words, pigmented black. So you would recommend more like a natural concrete instead with a gray tone?
Yes.
Okay, Calvin, how about on your side?
I actually agree with Mr. Rick Yelton's statement there. It's very hard to get that uniform black pigment on your concrete. And I'm a material science major, so I understand also one of the things that we studied is the absorption of light in dark materials on black material. So it's a great absorber, and just to mention, white is a great reflector. So it's mostly used in temperate areas. So I agree that the black concrete is very hard to get a uniform color, and I would rather recommend using the natural color of concrete.
So it's, in other words, it's not a hearsay, it's a matter of fact that black absorbs more heat. Because some people, of course, they would want to argue with you, like, it's okay, just paint it black and, you know, it will be this. So, okay. But having the natural concrete color is more, what do you call it, practical in terms of exterior application. Okay, are there some more questions? Christelle, do we have more time? Hello? Okay. Okay. So I don't see any other questions on the Q&A. So can I? Oh, we still have more 10 minutes. Okay. So anything additional information on your part, Calvin?
So I just want to add as well that Cold Shop Construction Chemicals, we are willing to also partner with interested contractors and interested professionals to learn about how concrete is being developed as an aesthetic element here in the Philippines. We actually do on-site mock-ups or the product demonstrations, and we're very willing to go there and get the professionals involved as well as the people there who are doing the finishes themselves. And yeah.
So how many K you have? You have Canyon, Kaiser, Cole, did I miss something?
We have we have actually 9 Ks that we have.
Oh, okay. And there's the Archistone that you mentioned.
Yes.
Okay. And all these are available in the market now, particularly in the depots or in the paint centers?
The materials that are required to do those finishes are actually already in the depots today.
Okay, so which means do we need to call on like the technical from Boysen Paints to help the clients or the architects or the contractors to discuss with them? Initially, even before the application, correct?
That's correct, architect.
Okay, somebody's asking Mr. Henrico, website links please on decorative concrete. So maybe Mr. Rick Yelton can also send us the link, and we'll ask Global Link to send the link to everybody, both from Mr. Yelton and Mr. Calvin. Mr. Yelton, any additional information about surface treatment in terms of decorative concrete?
Well, you know, that I was thinking here about, you asked before, where can an architect or design professional learn more about decorative concrete? There is a one of my best friends has written a number of books on it. His name is Bob Harris, H-A-R-R-I-S. And he has a website called the Decorative Concrete Institute. And he has a series of almost 10 books now that are really written for the design professional to learn about the different applications and just as importantly, how to write the specifications for that, so a contractor knows what to do. So that's a really, really good resource, Bob Harris, and his website's the Decorative Concrete Institute.
Is he a good friend of you, Mr. Yelton?
I have placed concrete with him on maybe 15, 20 jobs, and I got paid, so he's a good friend.
Maybe we can ask Global Link and Boysen Paints to host another webinar together with Bob Harris. Can we have that? And that's very important, especially to the industry, to the trade industry, the architects, the designers, and even to upcoming young student of architecture. Okay? Yeah, so those are very interesting information about concrete, decorative concrete surfaces today. Are there more questions? Let's see. Okay, so far, yeah. Oh, okay. Another question from Henrico. Application for sculptural architecture. What do you mean? He wants a website. But I don't know. How do you describe a sculptural architecture? Is it iconic architecture in terms of form and design? Mr. Yelton, can you share some?
I guess if you were going to look on a website, I would, if you were going to Google a term, look for carved concrete, C-A-R-V-E-D.
And carved, okay.
Carved. So that describes a technique. Many of the practitioners create their own mixture. It's almost like sometimes they have perlite in it or vermiculite or different mixtures that they apply to the wall, and they let it harden just enough, and they come back and scrape it out. So carved concrete is that term that's being used for vertical form work like that.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Yelton. But yeah, me as an architect, I just want to share, like, I use a lot of concrete in expression of my architectural design, because it's the flexibility of the application in terms of curve, and not only in straight lines, but in terms of curve and form, like my iconic design of the kite house, which is like a curved slab form, it's like a pliant material that you can form in any direction that you want. You just need a good constructor to execute the proper form using, you know, techniques, correct? What can you suggest?
Well, you know, there's a couple really cool architects right now that are using formed concrete out of fabric formed concrete. In other words, it's a material that's stronger than burlap, and they actually create wide range arcs and elements to it all. And if you look up it's really a cool project right now using these fabric formed products, and it allows a designer to put more curves into a wall than a straight form can do. So fabric formed concrete is the term to Google on the website. Fabric formed concrete.
Fabric form, which means you're not using like a sheetrock or a plywood board. So you're using fabric. What kind of fabric is this? Is it like a carbon fiber or something?
It depends on, again, not to bore you with the details, it really depends on the surface texture you want afterwards, right? So sometimes you can use some burlap fibers, the burlap material that gives a nice little rough look to it all. Sometimes you can incorporate you can use like you said, a carbon fiber to it all. There's a wide range. A guy named, I know I'm going to get it wrong, but I think his name is, I know he's a professor. I know his last name is Bell.
B-E-L-L-E?
B-E, boy, E-L-L. And he's a professor at University of Texas. And he's an architect, engineer kind of guy. And he really has been sponsoring a lot of these showcases of how this fabric form concrete can happen. And there's also a design engineer out of Saskatchewan, Canada that's into it as well. So what you're describing is starting to become a kind of a cool way to use concrete in structures to give a lot of different curves to it.
Okay, another thing that I want to ask you, Mr. Yelton, is you mentioned about obsidian, right?
Yep.
And I know that that's one of the earliest mineral, even before the start of cities in the world, being traded in Turkey. I myself haven't seen that, but is it color black?
Obsidian is a quartz that's black all the way through. So it's a very, 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 very dark material. There are companies that are making carbon black that can be applied to concrete. But when I see black surfaces on concrete, there's two things that are happening. One, in order to help create a better environment, we want to try to make our cities more reflective so that the light reflects off our structures and doesn't retain. So to create structures that have black things on them, embedded in them, that's kind of contrary to what we are trying to do, build a sustainable community. On the other side of the coin, I have seen some architects create very small black panels that are embedded onto the concrete when it's being cast to create the difference between dark and black. So the normal time when I see that dark image, it's normally something that's been embedded into the concrete to provide that starkness.
Okay, thank you very much. By the way, Mr. Yelton, his name is Architect Brad Bell.
That's him. That's him. That's right. That's right.
I Googled him immediately, of course.
Yeah,
So, audience, you can Google his name, Architect Brad Bell. Now, Calvin, talking about curvature in concrete in terms of surface application, how does Construct and your other products, you know, when you paint a flat surface, is different when you paint a curved surface in terms of application, consistency, and how to mitigate? Will there be cracking where you apply it on the curved surface?
So one of the most important things to always take note of is the curing time of the concrete. Be it a straight or a curved, it's important to understand that concrete must cure prior to any building material on top of it. So after it's curing, it depends on the mastery actually of the contractors when the building materials are applied. So for skin coats, usually we have trainings here if contractors are interested in learning about how our finishes are done. And yeah, so I think one of the most important things is the curing time for concrete prior to application of building materials and the training, the mastery of the contractors themselves.
Thank you, Calvin. I think there are two iconic architects that I know who use a lot of curved concrete. Number one, of course, the late Zaha Hadid. Both exterior and interior, because I have seen, if I may mention the product, the Roca showroom in London is all made of precast concrete, curved concrete. And another European architect that I am fond of is like Santiago de Calatrava. Well, he did one in New York, right? Rick, the terminal in New York, is that made of concrete or steel?
I'm not sure. I'm an engineer. All I worry about is I don't know. I really don't know.
I think part of the roof is steel, which costs billions for, you know, I think it costs a fortune for the New Yorkers, but I find it iconic. But I have seen his works in Valencia in Spain, and he's very famous for a rib-like dinosaur skeletal forms made of concrete as well. And of course, the morphology of her forms is like from transfixed from the earth, from the mineral. Okay, so thank you very much with the great information and learning that we had today about decorative concrete surfaces from Mr. Rick Yelton and of course Calvin Trilles from Boysen Paint. Thank you very much. And for those who all sent their questions, thank you very much for participating in this webinar. And thank you Global Link and Boysen Paint for this opportunity and inviting me over. Last word from Mr. Rick Yelton before we sign off.
Thank you. You know, the use of concrete, we can make a more resilient world.
Thank you, Rick. And of course, Mr. Calvin Trilles.
Please follow us at facebook.com/constructchem for more information about.
Okay. So with this, I'm your moderator for today, Architect James Howe, signing off. Thank you and have a nice day.
That was a fruitful discussion. Thank you, Rick, Calvin, and James, for sharing your valuable time and knowledge with us. We have more discussions coming up. We'll have Shella Gonzalez and Meryl Yu for their remake for New Times at 1 p.m. and the Philippine Institute of Interior Designers for a lifestyle show at 3:30 p.m. Don't forget to check out Hotel and Restaurant Suppliers in the exhibition hall and follow our Facebook and Instagram page at Hotel Supplier Show for more updates. See you later!